all those who are in the front lines of this pandemic. Thank you. This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
More COVID-19 infections being recorded across all age groups here in the Philippines. Meanwhile, some children afflicted with COVID-19 dealing with inflammation of the organs. Philippine Senator Grace Poe asks the Senate to look into the plight of micro, small, and medium enterprises amid the pandemic. We'll be speaking with Senator Poe later on in the program. And the rest of Team Philippines arriving home today after giving the country its best ever finish in the Olympics. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. We begin with the latest on the Philippines' battle against the pandemic. The health department says the increase in COVID-19 cases is not only prevalent among children, but across all age groups. The clarification comes amid concerns more children are getting hospitalized due to the coronavirus. On Sunday, the Philippines recorded its highest daily death toll since April 9th at 287. This brings the total number of COVID-19 deaths in the country to 29,000. Over 9,600 new infections were also recorded. The number of active cases now at 77,516, the highest since April 24th. Doctors on high alert for a rare condition among children with COVID-19. Multisystem inflammatory syndrome in childhood, or MIS-C, results in the inflammation of bodily organs such as the heart, lungs, kidneys, brain, and even the skin. Some of its symptoms are fever, abdominal pain, diarrhea, vomiting, and rashes. According to the Philippine General Hospital, Miss C has been observed in one of their young COVID-19 patients.
Doon po sa tatlo, dalawa po may comorbidities. Yung isa po ay wala, pero meron po siya nung tinatawag na Miss C, no? Yung multisystemic inflammatory syndrome in childhood, na yan po ay komplikasyon ng COVID. At ang nangyayari po sa kanila ay nagkaka-COVID sila. 2 weeks later, nagkakaroon po ng pamamaga ang iba't iba nilang mga organs, at doon po sila minsan nagkaka-problema, kaya nadadala po sa ospital.
This as hospitals have been reporting an increase in the number of children being admitted for COVID-19. The Delta variant is still not the dominant COVID-19 strain in the Philippines. That's according to Health Secretary Francisco Duque III, who also says it only accounts for 5% of all samples sequenced by the Philippine Genome Center. The Delta variant ranks third among other strains detected in the Philippines, next to the Beta and Alpha variants.
The PGC results, no, of their sequencing, it's not meant to guide clinical management. The protocol essentially remains, no? But we need to intensify. We need to intensify how by ensuring that our compliance, no, to the minimum public health standards is really strengthened, no? And the LGUs know exactly how to go about this. Mm-hmm. And then the early detection is key. We have to have aggressive identification, detection of cases, testing, and of course, contact tracing is key. Mm-hmm.
Duque adds there is always a possibility the 2-week enhanced community quarantine in Metro Manila and other COVID-19 hotspots may be extended. the main COVID-19 treatment center in Ilocos Norte running out of hospital beds. The chief of the Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital in Batac City says they're also looking to augment their staff, with 200 of their workers currently undergoing quarantine. The hospital chief also hopes more COVID-19 vaccines can be sent to their city.
We have not really been given as much vaccines as the problem areas in Mindanao, Visayas, even NCR. So, but then we were having very few cases then. And I was quiet about it because I knew a lot of NCR people needed the vaccines and we would get our share anyway. But and then this vaccine started coming. It was just about the time where the more cases started popping up.
The Philippine Food and Drug Administration evaluating the emergency use application of the Novavax COVID-19 vaccine. FDA Director General Eric Domingo says it is just waiting for Novavax's manufacturer to submit more requirements. Novavax claims it has an efficacy rate of about 90% against COVID-19 based on a study of nearly 300,000 people from the U.S. and Mexico, but there is still no data on how effective it is against variants of concern.
Sa ngayon po, wala pa po. Ano, yung pong nakakita kong original nila na submission ay wala pa, pero mukhang baka naman po may pahabol pa sila. Usually naman po, basta complete ang requirements, it takes us 21 days, no? Yun yung maximum na sireset natin.
Cavite Governor John Vic Remulla says the province will procure millions of doses from Novavax once it secures FDA authorization. Cavite is one of the provinces that is experiencing a surge in COVID-19 cases.
Kakaminting lang namin on Thursday ng Fabrico, we have reiterated our desire to purchase 1.5 million doses and another 1 million early next year, para makompleto natin ang herd immunity dito sa Cavite.
Chaos ensues at another COVID-19 vaccination site in Metro Manila. Hordes of people trooped to the Araneta Coliseum in Quezon City Sunday. Amid the spread of fake information, the local government was accepting walk-ins. But Quezon City clarifies individuals need to have an appointment prior to receiving their vaccinations.
We have already reached out to all authorities to help us with this particular task. Although I think that there is also a responsibility now on the shoulders of all online platforms. I think that this is something bigger than just Quezon City, you know, because this has happened all throughout Metro Manila and others as well outside of Metro Manila. And I think that this actually requires national government intervention.
Last week, thousands of people also flocked to vaccination sites in Manila, Las Piñas, and Antipolo. Government blamed the chaos on spreaders of fake information who allegedly said those unvaccinated will not be allowed to go out or receive cash aid during the lockdown. All 17 areas affected by the hard lockdown in Metro Manila will simultaneously begin to receive cash aid this Wednesday. Beneficiaries will include those who received assistance during the first two enhanced community quarantines. Around 10.7 million residents are entitled to the 1,000 peso cash aid or 4,000 pesos per family. This will be distributed over a span of 15 days.
Mix pong pagbibigay po niyan, merong electronic wallet at meron din pong face-to-face, pero sisiguraduhin po namin na may protocol po na maayos pamimigay. Magkakaroon po ng alphabetical yung ating beneficiary o kaya area by area.
As for the Labor Department, it says it will provide jobs to displaced workers.
Bibigyan namin sila ng 10 days of work and then ibigay namin yung sweldo nila. Eh, dahil NCR naman, and ang minimum wage dito sa NCR is 537 per day. Last 10 days, that means that we will give them 5,370. Yan. Yan ha, buo yan na Angelo, buo. Walang kartas yan kasi ang aming pagbayad sa kanila is through remittance center.
I'm going to take a break now. Up ahead, Tokyo passes the Olympic baton to Paris as the Summer Games come to an end. A wrap of the Summer Olympics and Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Sa eskwela, nagkakasubukan ng
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels.
And we are back. You're still with Dateline Philippines. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. More COVID-19 infections being reported across all age groups here in the Philippines. Meanwhile, some children afflicted with COVID-19 dealing with inflammation of the organs. Philippine Senator Grace Poe asks the Senate to look into the plight of micro, small, and medium enterprises amid the pandemic. And the rest of Team Philippines arriving home today after giving the country its best ever finish in the Olympics. Back with more news. Without a doubt, micro, small, and medium enterprises, or MSMEs, have been hit hard by this pandemic. Senator Grace Poe has already filed a resolution urging the Senate to look into their plight, particularly the food and beverage industry. Senator Poe now joins us here on the program. Good afternoon, Senator. Welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and to our viewers.
All right. Senator, the picture is clear. The MSMEs, they're not just taking a hit. I mean, if you look at big businesses that are forced to close down because of this pandemic, what more the MSMEs? So I guess the question is, how can a probe at this point into how the pandemic had impacted on these MSMEs help, Senator?
I think it's important to bring the leaders of the industry, of the different sectors, particularly the MSMEs, on a discussion, an open discussion, and I think the Senate can bring that about, to really hear from them the plight of the MSMEs. I'm sure that there's been other discussions in the Senate, but the focus of this will be on why it is crucial for the leaders of the MSMEs to have a representation in the IATF. The IATF at this point has been focused on the health situation of our country, which is, of course, very important. We have their experts, some experts from the health industry. We also have the local government representation for the ground. And we also have, of course, the members of the executive. Every now and then, Presidential Advisor Joey Concepcion sits in with the IATF to give the recommendations. But as we know, since the focus has been on health, sometimes we tend to forget that the economic health of our country is also very important. Of course, we can't work if we're sick, but if we're not sick and we're not able to work, then that's also crucial for survival. It affects the survival of many of our countrymen. So it's important that I think that we should have an IATF focused on economic recovery. Now, why is this important? MSMEs in particular compose 99% of businesses in the country. We know that. That's about a million businesses and about 5 million people at the minimum rely on these MSMEs. Now, at this point, 10% of the MSMEs already shut down. They're predicting about 16% more, or up until 16% this year alone. And we've seen that in the past weeks, the very abrupt decisions and policies of IATF on the closures of business have really negatively impacted many of the small business owners, particularly, and I will, this is my focus because I've had the chance to interact with some of them, the food and beverage industry.
Yeah.
I think they found out about the restricted GCQ with restrictions on the 29th, and they were supposed to shut down on the 30th. Nakapamalengke na ang mga may-ari ng mga restaurants na to. Remember, that's towards the weekend. So, gaano karaming pagkain ang nasayang dahil bigla na lang sinabi ng IATF, wala nang 20% dine-in or any dine-in whatsoever. Hmm. Now, they are all in agreement that a lockdown, perhaps, to stall the spread of the virus is necessary, but at least give them some lead time. And I think the reason why this came about is there's really not a direct communication, line of communication, between the policymakers of the IATF and the small business owners. Joey Concepcion is doing his best, but he is representing millions of people dependent on MSMEs. Remember, what composes the MSMEs? We have wholesale and retail. We have manufacturing. We have food and beverage, as well as accommodations and other businesses. So that's a lot. And so they really need a voice and a representation. Otherwise, arbitrary rules will be made to the detriment of not only the owners of these businesses, but to their employees as well.
Senator, here's the thing though. Government seems to think that their pandemic response has been stellar, right? So how do you even think that a probe like this could help them, you know, change their mind and provide a seat to represent the MSMEs? They seem to think that they're doing a good job.
Well, I really don't know maybe the pronouncements of some of their allies and their secretaries have been that. There's no denying that in other countries, they are suffering from the surge of this pandemic. I mean, even in the US alone, policies change every now and then. But of course, their economy is more resilient than ours. That's why we really need more, informed decisions from those directly affected by the pandemic. I hope that they will listen. When there's a probe in the Senate, at least it brings to light the issues. I mean, more people are made aware of it. I have some friends who own restaurants, and in fact, they were shocked. They found out on the 29th that they had to close the next day. So it's not very clear, and some are even suggesting dapat may direct Viber group ng MSMEs kasama ng IATF. Now, I don't know if that's in existence, but the fact of the matter is many of those MSMEs are not business owners, are not really aware that there's going to be a lockdown the following day until the very last minute, and they've already planned for the entire week. Remember, the weekend can make or break some businesses. And so while they're in agreement that we should have some sort of a lockdown, a good lead time would be very important. And another thing is, of course, in other countries, they've already reached the herd immunity that is ideal. Of course, here in our country, we have not. But we should already have a roadmap. If we are nearing towards herd immunity, what will our policies be? And right now, we are seeing that some business owners are going above and beyond making sure that their employees are all vaccinated. I know that there are some restaurants, and I know the owners, who delayed their opening until all of their employees, that including the security guards, including the maintenance workers, are vaccinated, not just the chefs or the waiters. And then they also require vaccine cards from those who are patronizing their indoor dining. So business owners are doing their best to be able to comply. So maybe it would be nice for them to know also from the government what the policies will be moving forward, what the contingencies are in case there's a surge, what lead time are they expecting, instead of some very unpredictable and sometimes quite arbitrary policies.
So not to mention, Senator, most of these MSMEs that we're talking about are not connected online, because some were able to turn around. Some were able to evolve quite quickly, that they were able to change their business into an online business. They have deliveries, they use fiber. But most of these MSMEs that we're talking about really aren't that connected. So yung sinasabi niyo po kanina na nasayang, yung pinamalengke, yung pinamili, that's really very real to them because they weren't able to turn things around as quickly as some businesses could.
Of course, because there's really a difference. Even if, let's say, you've adapted and you do deliveries already, like many restaurants, the fact is, if you are anticipating at least 20% indoor dining and 50% outdoor dining, the logistics is different. Like, how much are you going to buy as opposed to if you were only expecting deliveries? So that was a weekend where a lot of indoor dining was expected. And at the very last minute, they said that's no longer possible because what they were really tuned in on was the ECT that was going to follow, which was August 6, I believe.
Yeah.
To August 20. That's where their mindset was there. So they didn't expect that there would be an earlier lockdown for them. So they've already prepared for that weekend. So So kahit nasabihin mo na marami sa kanilang nagde-delivery, eh syempre dahil ina-expect nila na may at least 20% indoor dining, 50% outdoor dining, iba yung kanilang mga pinamili para sa mga araw na darating na yon. Kaya simple lang naman yung kanilang hinihingi. Sana bigyan nyo naman kami ng kahit man lang isang linggo ng palugit para makapaghanda naman kami ng maayos. Hindi naman siguro masama yun na hingin sa ating mga namumuno at sa ehekutibo.
And Senator, we're just talking about the business owners here. We haven't talked about their workers yet. I mean, when you look at the numbers, Senator, the numbers are quite staggering. This is coming from Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Carl Chua. More than 600,000 workers will be affected by the lockdowns right now. And some work for big businesses, some work for MSMEs. And a portion of these workers that we're looking at, Senator, are at risk of permanently losing their jobs. What do you think? What can government do at this point? Sabihin na natin hindi pa nangyayari yung probe po ninyo. But what can government do at this point to salvage the situation?
Well, of course, we at the Senate, we've pushed for Bayanihan 1 and 2. Now we're pushing for Bayanihan 3, at least to have some sort of direct financial assistance for those who are losing their or who have lost their jobs. Remember, I think we've had, 16 months of lockdown? And if you were making, let's say, 20,000 pesos a month, that's on the high average end already. 20,000 pesos would probably be about more than 300,000 pesos for that lockdown. But those people only received 16,000. So that's about 5% of what they usually make. Remember, ang ayuda 16,000 lang kasi 2 months yun. And this is NCR. Ha? It's in the lower end outside of NCR. So if you're making 350,000 in those 16 months or 320,000, you're making less than 5% of what you used to make. Now, restaurant owners, let's say their base is about 10,000 for their waiters, they rely on tips and service charges, which is about 8,000. So even if, let's say, these restaurant owners, which is really difficult, huh? Let's say you have 2,000 employees, how can you pay them even a minimum of 4,000 a month if you're not in operation? So yes. What can the government do? So we have that Bayanihan, and hopefully now there will be more direct financial assistance. The government said that they're releasing through DBM 10 billion. That's well and good. But remember, 30 billion is lost in this two-week lockdown alone on wages. So that's quite not enough. Another thing is, maybe we can discuss in the future tax holidays for certain MSME owners. I don't know if this is possible, but we can look into that. I, on the other hand, as a committee chair on banks and financial institutions, mm-hmm. we passed the Financial Institution Strategic Transfer Act, which will allow banks and financial institutions to sell their non-performing assets and loans, so that it will free up capital and they will be able to loan it to these medium, small MSMEs. Mm-hmm. Now, it's also important that the land bank and the DPP actually act as a government bank and give to small enterprises as opposed to acting like a commercial bank.
Mm-hmm.
At this time, if we look at the, I guess, the loan portfolio of the land bank and the DDP, we'd also like to explore where did they use up the loans that they've given out? Are they helping MSMEs truly? So these are the things that we can look into now. But moving forward, we need a more holistic and informed decision by including those in the MSMEs at the table of the decision-making process of the executive.
Mm. And Senator, you said in your statement over the weekend, and I quote, "We need to be at least one step ahead because every lockdown can feel like we're taking two steps back." Again, I go to the figures released by Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Carl Chua. In the lockdowns this time around, ECQ season 3, we're looking at poor Filipinos increasing by 250,000, Senator. That's not just two steps back, right?
Well,
Those figures are staggering. So I guess the question is, what is, I mean, you've conducted these hearings, you know what's going on. What is your assessment? What is preventing the government from being proactive, from looking at the future, what can possibly happen, instead of being reactionary, Senator?
You know, if you say that I know what's going on, I'll admit to you, I don't really know what's going on all the time. I mean, we ourselves in the executive, I mean, in the legislative branch, are sometimes in the dark also as to what the current policies are of the executive. Now, this is new for everybody, but we've already seen examples in other countries.
Exactly.
One of the things that I proposed when we were deliberating Bayanihan 2 and then we were tackling the funding for the vaccines was I was already proposing having a vaccine passport at that point. And I was saying because it needs to be standardized, because when our countrymen travel abroad, especially the OFWs, it's hard to show one from their municipio that's not been authenticated, right? If it's not standardized. Unfortunately, there was a hurdle amongst ourselves, you know, those waiving the rights of people not to be discriminated upon. Anyway, fast forward. Now, when you travel abroad, let's say, okay, a friend of mine is traveling abroad, and in some venues there, they require an authenticated vaccine card. Mm-hmm. And you can only get that from the Bureau of Quarantine here in the Philippines, because it's not standard yet. So it's difficult because you have to make an appointment. It takes weeks to get an appointment. What if your trip is already, you know, in the next 2 weeks? So it's not a very well-oiled machine that we have right now. And I don't know what I'm not really in the know, because I don't have a seat at the table of the IATF, okay? Even the Senate itself, yes, we approve the budgets, we legislate, but when it comes to executive decisions, we are not consulted regularly about those things. That's
should
why.
Should you be, Senator? What do you think?
I'm sorry?
Should you be consulted? Should the Senate have a seat there? Should the Senate have a say?
Well, okay. I don't want to add a layer of bureaucracy to anything. But what I'm saying is the Senate can help within our purview by conducting these hearings and submitting those recommendations to the executive. That's why that's what we're doing. We're not going to insist, oh, give us a seat at the table. We have our own mandate. We will work within that mandate. But with them, I think it's incumbent upon them to be inclusive in their consultations. And we don't have to have 100 people at the table. We just need to have a representative, let's say, of the PCCI, a representative of the restaurants group, Mr. Teng, Mr. Cuenca, I believe. These people who contacted our office with regards to the plight of the restaurant sector. So I don't think it's too much to ask to have that. We're not even saying include the Senate there. But definitely the Senate, I feel it's incumbent upon us to include these stakeholders in a discussion so that we can have a comprehensive recommendation to give the IATF, and hopefully they will consider that.
Yeah, so we're talking today not just about the current plight, but also, as you mentioned a while ago, recovery. We're talking about roadmap as well. And one would think that the best way to address the recovery of this sector is to give them an allotment in the national budget that would precisely address this issue. But then you hear an agency like the NTF-LCAP, for example, getting close to a $30 billion increase. Do you think, Senator, that the 2022 national budget is going to be reflective of how and what or what the national government should prioritize come 2022, Senator?
Certainly on my end, and I believe many of my colleagues will really push for this budget to address the situation that we have. So the focus will be on having enough to be able to roll out a decent and effective vaccine program. So the money allotted for procuring vaccines. It's important also for us to be able to set aside some money in case we have to do certain localized lockdowns or even a national lockdown. We should be able to put out to have a contingency for that scenario. And I think that moving forward, we also have to have a discussion on how maybe government can give certain tax breaks for those affected by the pandemic. Remember, if MSMEs are affected, even the big conglomerates eventually will take a big hit because they're the ones that are leasing spaces from these different malls and from different places. In fact, we've already seen the effect of that with the tale, I keep saying, the tale of two Shangri-Las. Shangri-La Makati, which closed down early during the pandemic, and you have the iconic Shangri-La Chinese restaurant that's been in operation for 37 years in Quezon mm-hmm. City. So no one is spared by this. And I think in as much as we are focused on getting the right approach for the health crisis, we should also look at the economic crisis, which will definitely affect the survival of our countrymen, just as their health situation will affect their survival.
Senator, how can you even hope that that will be addressed by the government when we look at the frontliners? And to this day, a year and a half into the pandemic, they're still clamoring for what is due them.
You know, Carmina, that is so infuriating and so disappointing because, you know, us in the executive, us in the legislative branch, we already gave the budget to the DOH. And then they also have, of course, PhilHealth. For them to be able to cover the insurance and benefits of the healthcare workers. Now the problem is in the disbursement of that. Our constituents come to us individually, senators, asking, you know, our mother died as a frontliner. She was a healthcare worker, and the 1 million promise was not given, months delayed. It had to take our office to write the DOH and the IATF for it to be released. Not everybody would probably know what to do in a situation like that. At least this person thought, well, they're my representatives in the Senate. I will approach them. How about the hundreds more who weren't able to make it to our office to let us know about it? Mm-hmm. And of course, you hear not only that, but even from the local government, the mayors, particularly in Iloilo, was begging the IATF and even told me that our hospitals here, both private and public, are not being reimbursed by the PhilHealth. So what's going to happen is they'll have to turn patients away because they don't have their operating costs anymore. So I get it. They're probably being careful with their disbursements. But, you know, at some point, you're just going to have to bite the bullet and say, this is the average cost of the health expenditures in other hospitals. Why don't they release it as quickly as they can? I mean, you have the NPF LTAC with an intelligence fund that's not subject to audit. You know, the intention may be good. I mean, to build communities, but that's not part of an audit system like what PhilHealth has to go through. And yet, PhilHealth being audited, we've seen that there's still so much anomaly going on. So, you know, at this point, I think 6 billion pesos was returned to the national government. Is it 6 billion or more? Unspent funds for Bayanihan 2. Ano ba naman yung 6 billion na yon? Mas okay na i-download diretso yun sa mga recipients. At least pera yan sa bulsa nila. Sabi ko nga, that will eventually make its way to the economy because these people will buy their necessities. They'll buy their food. They'll pay transportation. You know, it will go to services, it will pay for things, it will go back to the economy. So wag pag hinayangan ang social amelioration program, ang unconditional cash transfer, kasi diretso sa bulsa ng mga kababayan natin.
Senator, before we let you go, I want to talk about 2022. Earlier on, you already made up your mind, right? You said you're not going to be a part of it. You have no intention to run, even if you have the 22 million vote that's backing you up. Why did you decide earlier on that you're not going to throw your hat into the ring?
No, let me make this clear. The question at the time was, I was being included by Sambayan, which I was grateful for the trust. But at that time, I mean, at this time, really the focus is trying to figure out how we can get out of this rut. And, you know, they were trying to figure out who the best candidates are for president. I said, I've done that. I'm not interested to run as president. And I feel that at this point, it's really important. And I think it's good to have as much open discussions as those who are truly interested to run, so that people can make an informed decision. I think it's important right now that the public evaluate how their public servants are serving them or not serving them. And that should really be the focus of the campaign, educating our voters. And I was actually taken aback that I was being considered by somebody for that position when I've been quite clear about my position.
So you're going to stay, you're going to continue on with your legislative work. You know, your colleagues, there's a lot of things happening there at the Senate. You have the tandem shaping up between Senator Panfilo Lacson, Senate President Vicente Soto III, Senator Manny Pacquiao has his own issues. Senator Bongo, also part of a Go-Duterte tandem. I'm not going to focus on that. But what is clear now is the kind of legislative work that is expected of you guys if we were to talk about the recovery of this country. What are you looking for in a colleague once election is over and, you know, you got your new set of colleagues there at the Senate, you've got your work cut out for you. What are you looking for in a team member there at the Senate post the 2022 national election, Senator?
It will be the same, and probably our work will probably be more difficult because of all the recovery efforts that we need to do. So, you know, we are in a democratic system. People are free to choose who they want. But it's important to have a legislator who's dedicated, who really has his work in his or her work in the Senate as the number one priority that they have. It's important that their intentions are really to help and to help alleviate the situation of our countrymen. That would be ideal for them to be competent. Now, ako naman kasi, hindi naman pwedeng mang mata at sabihin, ito lamang ang mga pwede sa Senado, yung mga nakapagtapos o yung mga abogado. Kahit naman simpleng, ordinaryong mga mamayan, ang importante, nakatutok sa trabaho at nakikipag-usap sa kanyang mga kababayan para malaman kung anong kailangan. At kung ano man yung kailangan na yun, yun ang ipaglaban sa Senado. Diba? Kahit naman hindi ka engineero, hindi ka abogado, pwede mo naman gawin yan.
All right. We're going to have to leave it at that. I'm sure we're going to talk about a lot of things later on in the year. But first, I just want to go back to what you said a while ago. You said at that time, that was the question. Are you still considering it though? Because that seemed to be it was open-ended for you running for the presidency.
You know what? This is what's important right now. I feel that my focus will be to have a relevant part in 2022. And that would be perhaps even campaigning or going all out for a cause, which I feel will be beneficial for our country. What cause will that be? It will be a cause where I feel that our country has to unite under one particular goal, which is everybody should have an equal opportunity to progress. There should be a definite respect for the rule of law. There should also be a focus on rebuilding our economy. These are causes and goals that I would like to have moving forward in 2022 in any capacity. So, however, I'll be able to advance that, to take an active role, to support anyone. I think we should all do that.
As a senator? Or
as a senator, as a private individual, just like you, as a media personality, to actually ferret out the truth and report it to our countrymen.
And not necessarily as a candidate.
Not necessarily as a candidate. You can do a lot, even if you're not a candidate.
Senator Graceful, we appreciate you coming to the show. Thanks a lot. You continue to keep safe and you take care.
You as well. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thanks. Right, moving on. It was mission accomplished for Tokyo following its successful hosting of the Summer Olympics amid the pandemic. Our very own Migs Bustos now joins us with details on the closing ceremonies and more. Migs, over to you.
Thank you, Casey. Tokyo doused its Olympic flame on Sunday in a ceremony that echoed the restraint of the Games held without spectators. But for its organizers, the Tokyo Olympics should serve as a great symbol of hope as it overcame unprecedented setbacks brought by the pandemic.
Tokyo capped the 2020 Olympics on Sunday with a dazzling fireworks display, a celebratory image in contrast with an event that was not the financial windfall Japan had hoped for after postponing the Games for a year due to a global health crisis. Organizers said the unprecedented event held mostly without spectators would serve as a symbol of world triumph.
I'm only sure that nobody who took part in these Games will ever forget these Olympic Games. They are unique, and there are a great manifestation and a great symbol of hope for the people across the globe. There are a great manifestation of solidarity which made these games happening, and there are a great manifestation of peace, because without solidarity there is no peace.
But while organizers appeared to prevent the Tokyo Games from spiraling into a super spreader event, daily COVID-19 infections in the host city ballooned during the games, spiking to more than 5,000 for the first time in Tokyo and threatening to overwhelm its hospitals. Despite restrictions being in place, people gathered for the closing ceremony outside Tokyo's National Stadium, where roughly 100 protesters carrying signs that read "Olympics kill the poor" and "We don't need the Olympics" clashed with police. Public opinion polls showed most Japanese citizens opposed holding the games during a worldwide health crisis. In the end, Japan was saddled with a $15 billion bill, double what it initially expected, and with no tourism boom. But a record medal haul for the host nation may have helped to take out some of the sting for Japan, which won 27 gold medals. The United States finished at the top of the pack with 39 gold medals, one more than rival China at 38.
Tokyo passes the Olympic baton to Paris. At the closing ceremony on Sunday, Paris Mayor Anne Hidalgo accepted and waved the Olympic flag from International Olympic Committee President Thomas Bach. Thousands of Paris residents also joined in on the fun, gathering in front of the Eiffel Tower. The Tokyo Olympics may be over, but it's certainly one for the books for Team Philippines. The Philippines had a historic run in the Summer Games with its 4-medal haul, its best showing in the Olympics so far. It was also enough to top Southeast Asia's medal tally. Weightlifter Heidelin Diaz won the country's first ever Olympic gold medal, while the Philippine boxing team nabbed 2 silvers, courtesy of Nesty Petesho and Carlo Paalam, and 1 bronze from Yumir Marshall. Heidelin returned home shortly after her golden moment, while the rest of Team Philippines are flying back later today. Before their flight home, I was able to speak to bronze medalist Yumir Marshall on his plans for his multi-million peso cash reward and if he will still try to deliver the Philippines' first ever Olympic gold in boxing.
Siyempre, inisip ko din yung future ng magiging pamilya ko, dahil nagpaplano din po kami magkasal ng fiancé ko. Wala pa naman sa ngayon, pero siyempre, hopefully makapagsimula ng negosyo o makapagtayo ng bahay para po sa magiging pamilya namin. And siyempre tulong po sa pamilya, dahil yun po din talaga yung unang-unang goal ko. Bakit nandito ako sa boxing, dito ako nag-sasakripisyo para po sa pamilya ko, na matulungan ko na makaahon sa kahirapan. Yes po, sir. Yung pangarap ko na makakuha ng gold sa Olympics, nandito pa rin yun, sir. At kumbaga, sinubukan pa ako ng Panginoon, binigyan pa ako ng pagsubok na anak ko gusto mo magsikap ako lalo. So yan, yun po yung goal ko. Yun yung po yung pangarap ko. Hanggang malakas po ako, hanggang makapag-represent po ako ng sa bansa natin, kung ibibigyan po ako ng opportunity, makalahok at mag-represent niyan, talagang igagrab ko po yun.
For an assessment of the just concluded Tokyo Olympics, we're joined by DW News Germany sports correspondent Oliver Moody, who covered the games, and he's reporting. He's with us straight from Tokyo, Japan. Thank you so much, Ollie, for joining us here this afternoon on Dateline Philippines. Ollie, how successful was IOC in organizing committee without it becoming a super spreader event?
I think the IOC is going to be pretty happy with the numbers ultimately. It was just over 400 people who were accredited for the games who tested positive for COVID in the end. Now, that might sound like a lot, but bear in mind that takes into account not only the athletes, but also officials and judges and journalists like me too. So that's a lot of people who were being tested there. And ultimately, they were able to stop any major outbreaks within the bubble. There were a couple of dicey moments. At one point, the whole Australian track and field team had to isolate over fears that they may have been exposed. At another point, the entire the Greek artistic swim team had several positive cases. So those were two moments, for example, where things could have gotten out of control, but ultimately they were contained. And I think the IOC will be happy with how the games have gone from that point of view.
Can you tell us more about the protocols, Ollie, not only for athletes, but also journalists? I know journalists and media were also tested daily. How is it like from your perspective?
Well, that's right. Basically, there were three steps to the protocol. So before we actually traveled to Japan, there was a lot of bureaucracy. I won't bore you with all the details, but a lot of paperwork, much more than I had before Rio 2016. But more importantly, we had to do two PCR tests before we left and then another one upon landing in Tokyo at the airport. We couldn't leave the airport until we had our negative result back. Then for the first 14 days in Japan, we were very limited. We leave the hotel basically to go to games venues to work basically, and for 15 minutes to go out and get ourselves food and drinks and stuff like that. We couldn't sit in restaurants. We couldn't use public transport. These were the kind of things we had to deal with for public safety. And then at the venues themselves, of course, so whenever we went into a venue, we had to disinfect our hands. We had our temperature checked too. That's along with the usual security checks, the body scanner, the bag scanner. And of course, throughout the games, we were tested regularly. And the closer journalists were to athletes, the more often they had to be tested. And the athletes themselves had even tighter restrictions than that. They often weren't able to leave the Olympic Village at all, apart from for their events.
Well, you mentioned a couple of moments with a couple of teams also having close calls, but I guess that goes to show the organizing committee and how much work they put in for not for the Tokyo Olympics not to blow up and to be a super spreader event. And at the end, it was a successful Tokyo Olympics. What was the closing ceremonies like, Ollie?
Well, as you can imagine, it was pretty spectacular visually. You know, lots of great light shows, fireworks, you know, some nice artistic routines as well. And I think it was really great for the athletes themselves. You know, athletes had to arrive kind of as late as possible in Tokyo before their event started and then had to leave, in fact, within 48 hours of their last event at Tokyo. So they didn't have long here. And that means it was probably an almost entirely different set of athletes at the closing ceremony to the ones we saw at the opening ceremony. I think it was nice for them to have their moments. And it was interesting as well, amusing, because we had the medal ceremonies for the two marathons actually during the closing ceremony. And that meant that because both the marathon winners were Kenyan, we heard the Kenyan national anthem twice in the space of about 5 minutes. So I can remember that one pretty well now. But overall, I think it was a great way to close out the games.
Now, Ollie, I know you're very familiar with the Philippines and its sports landscape. And you also got to, you mentioned to me earlier that you also got to watch Nesty Petesio's gold medal match, rather. And also EJ Obiena's pole vault final. What was the atmosphere like in those venues?
Well, at the boxing, there really was quite a great atmosphere. There were a couple of guys sitting behind me with a Philippine flag out, you know, really rooting for Nesty. And didn't she do so well in that fight as well. Really put up such a great fight. But of course, coming up against a Japanese fighter, a home fighter, there were, of course, a lot of people rooting for her too. So we really did have quite a good atmosphere at the boxing, in spite of the fact that there were no spectators allowed in, apart from those accredited for the games. At the Athletics, it was a bit different. The stadium was so big. It was a kind of cavernous space, and only really one side was kind of half filled on the lower floor with journalists and officials and so on. And it was just so much harder for the people there to really fill the space with atmosphere. So a bit more difficult for EJ Obiena with the pole vault, but it really did go from venue to venue. You know, in some places there were enough people to kind of raise the spirits, and in other places it didn't quite happen in the same way. But of course, that's what you're going to get when you don't have spectators at the Olympic Games.
All right. So thank you so much, Oliver Moody, for your time here on ANT. But lastly, Ollie, witnessing on how Tokyo and the organizing committee staged this event, many thought that this would be canceled, but they pulled through. It was a successful event. Do you think that does this give other major sports organizations a blueprint on holding this huge of a sporting event? How crucial is it now for Paris to maintain maybe the same standard or maybe surpass it, Ollie?
Well, I think the thing is that Paris can learn from Tokyo. You know, there were some things that Tokyo tried to do that I don't think quite worked. Again, this is to get into the kind of nitty-gritty, the bureaucracy, so I won't go into too much detail, but there were certain things that seemed kind of unnecessary, and Paris can learn from that and say, okay, we don't need to do that, but this worked particularly well, we'll do that. Of course, hopefully, we'll be talking about Paris 2024 when it swings around as being the first post-COVID mass global event. We have to cross our fingers and hope that that's the case. But if not, Paris can use this as a blueprint. It can develop from this. It won't be as surprised by COVID as the Tokyo Games was. It won't have to come up with things quite so spontaneously, quite so quickly. And from that point of view, we should hopefully see an even better organized event in France in 2024.
All right, so there you have it. DW News sports correspondent Oliver Moody. Ollie, thank you so much for joining us here in ANC. Stay safe and God bless. Thanks, Ollie.
Pleasure as always, Mix. Thank you.
Thank you, Ollie. And that's all from my end. Casey, back to you.
Thanks a lot, Migs. Appreciate it. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Pranina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
The overseas voter registration for the 2022 Philippine elections is still open until September 2021. Bring your ballot.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.